morning and welcome to Immanuel Baptist Church here on May the 31st, 2020. Several weeks ago, we looked in Scripture and we're seeing how the earth is groaning under the curse of our sin. And stories in the news will continue to give evidence of that, right? Whether it's a viral pandemic that's impacting the whole globe, whether it's human brutality and cruelty that breaks our heart, whether it's swarms of locusts that are destroying large regions of vegetation on the earth, the evidence is there that earth is groaning under the curse of sin. But if you step outside this morning and look up, you'll also see the evidence is there that the Lord God sits above it all. That the Lord God is sustaining us. That God is going to have the final word. Jesus Christ, through his sacrifice on the cross and his resurrection, he assured that someday there'll be a final redemption of this earth. Until that day, what is our purpose? God has called us to come to him in faith, find great comfort in his sustaining power, a hurting world around us. And so that's our prayer, that this service may indeed move us forward in that hope of God's sustaining power and our ability to take that to a hurting world. Let's worship him now together.
I'm Kathleen Thompson, the office administrator here at Immanuel Baptist Church, and I just wanted to remind you about our online resources. Our church website is ibclife.org. We can be found on Facebook, Instagram, or YouTube. Download our Church Center app. Feel free to give us a call if we can answer any questions for you. God bless you, and have a great day.
You will not abandon, you will not forsake, you Greg here, again with another object lesson for the kids. We're going to do this now live, so if you have any kids there at home, you want to gather close, kids, this is going to be especially for you. If you don't have any kids there, parents, grandparents, you want to try this later, it'll be a pretty neat thing for you to try to recreate. See, the problem we have is we're all sinful people, and our sin separates us from God. Romans 3:23 says, all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. And in Romans 6:23, it tells us the wages of sin is death. So sin is a big deal, and it separates us from God. So if you look down here, I'm going to show you an example, an illustration I have set up. You can see we have these objects here. We have down here on the bottom this jar of water that represents us. You come up here to the top, and this egg that represents God. And the problem we have is we're separated from God by all the things in here, and this pie plate is full of these little papers that have sin. Stuff like being selfish, yeah, I've done that. Disobeying our parents, yeah, I've done that. Maybe lying, yeah, I've done that. And our lives get full of sin, and see, the problem is God's a holy God, and our sin can't come into His presence. So we need something to knock the sin out of our lives. So if you see here, this broom is going to represent Jesus. Jesus is our sin buster. We need somebody to bust the sin out of our lives. So if this all works well, we're going to have a great illustration of how Jesus knocks the sin out of our lives. If it doesn't work well, we're going to have a good illustration of Pastor Greg about to be killed by his wife for making a mess in the living room. I hope this works out. So we place our broom on the floor, you step on one end of it, and Jesus, we need you to knock the sin out of our lives. So Jesus, you died on the cross, and you sacrificed yourself for our sins, and you rose again on the third day, and you said anyone who believes in you can have eternal life and have their sins forgiven. So let's give it a shot and see what happens here. You see that? Jesus came, and by dying on the cross, He knocked the sin out of our lives. And now, there's no more separation between us and God. Jesus actually comes and lives inside of our hearts through His Holy Spirit. And our sin is no more. The Bible says He takes our sin as far as the east is from the west, and He remembers them no more. So, kids, I want you to remember that Jesus is the sin buster. And no matter what you've done wrong, Jesus can forgive it. And He forgives all our sins in the past, all our sins in the present, and all our sins in the future. And all we have to do is put our faith in Him and ask Him to forgive us. I'm so happy that we have a sin buster, and His name is Jesus. See you next time.
Without hope, without light, till from heaven. rose from their tombs, and the angels stood in awe for the souls of all who have come to the Father are restored. And the church of Christ was born, then the Spirit lit the flame. Now this gospel truth of old shall not kneel, shall not faint. By its blood and in his name, in his freedom I am free. For the love of Jesus Christ, who has resurrected me.
Be with you. I'm Dave Betts. I'm the Immanuel Baptist Church treasurer. As treasurer, one of the items I concern myself with is managing church offerings, managing offerings from you, God's people. At Immanuel, there's a couple ways that we give, and you can even give just from the comfort of your own home. Often we receive checks. If you're so led to give by check, you can do that. You can write a check to the church office. The church office address is 233 East Main Street, Maple Shade, New Jersey, 08052. The other way to give is electronically. We use a service called Tithely. It's spelled T-I-T-H-E.L-Y, tithe.ly. And that comes in two forms. There's a web-based form where you can fill out a web form. The way to do that is to go to the church website. The church website is a great resource for many things, one of which is online giving. So if you go to ibclife.org, go ahead and scroll down, and you'll see a big banner that says online giving. Click that online giving button, and you're presented with the Tithely form where you can put in your name, your offering amount. You can choose whether you want to give to general fund or building fund, and then make a note that at the bottom of that form, there's also an option to choose whether you want to use credit card or ACH, which connects right to your bank account. That's the web portion of Tithely. Tithely is also available on a mobile platform. So if you go to the app store for your mobile platform, whether it's Android or iPhone, you can search for the Tithely app, again, T-I-T-H-E.L-Y. And download the app. When you download the app, the first thing you'll want to do is perform a search for Immanuel Baptist Church. And you'll see Immanuel Baptist Church, 233 East Main Street in the app. Select that as your church and then continue to fill out the forms and you can continue to give that way. Thank you so much for your caring heart. I can tell you that the pastors and all the ministry leaders continue to work hard to minister to you and to this community, and we're so grateful for them. Thanks so much, everybody.
You were the Word at the beginning, one with God, the Lord Most High. Your hidden glory in creation now revealed.
All right, hey everybody, Pastor Greg here. I'm with the Maple Shade Fire Chief. I'm going to ask him to introduce himself to everybody. Tell us who you are.
Hello, my name is Andrew Simonsick. I am the chief of the fire department. Been the chief for 5 years now.
How long have you been with the department here in Maple Shade?
I joined the department in 1982.
Wow.
So I've been here a few years.
So you've seen a few different people come and go.
Yes. Now, there's a few guys here that have been here for 65, 70 years almost now.
Wow.
So I don't have them beat, but
you're getting close.
I'm catching up to them.
So everyone here is a volunteer, right? There's no paid staff for Maple Shade?
Yeah, everyone here in the department is completely volunteer. No one is paid. It's just townspeople that I guess want to give back and join. A lot of second generation people coming in, like my son's in here. So there's a lot of that in the fire department here, where it's, you know, kind of a tight-knit family when it comes to personnel. So, but yeah, we have about 60 people on the books, and you know, like I said, they're all volunteer, and you know, we're fortunate that we can provide the service to the town that we do, you know, on a daily basis. So
we very much appreciate that, especially all you Maple Shade residents.
Well, believe it or not, I mean, you know, I mean me specifically, and I can probably speak for most of them, it's not like we're doing it. We just like doing it. I mean, I fell in love with doing it when I was 18, and I mean, it's none of us are looking for anything in return. It's just one of those things. It's an unusual hobby that I call it a hobby, but I mean, you know, it's fun for us, I guess, in a lack of better description. But
well, let me ask you about the lockdown and the quarantine. Are you guys still meeting together? I know Monday nights is usually your meeting night, and you have drills.
What we wound up doing was we from the department from the aspect of our meetings, drills. We have bingo on Tuesday nights, which we closed, you know, to try and minimize exposure for the guys. I mean, you got to remember, we're all volunteers. So for me, I would rather them not be up here. And if somebody got sick, it wouldn't spread, because we are depending on them to come and go to the calls. So if the whole department gets sick because we're interacting and up
right
here, it becomes a challenge for us. So we decided, in the best interest of the department and everything, just to kind of shut everything down until everything passed. So,
I
know the bingo people weren't happy when we did that, but, you know.
Yeah, everybody's got to make a sacrifice.
Right exactly.
Well, that's good. Well, tell me, Andrew, obviously you're a volunteer, so you don't get paid to serve here, so you work outside of the fire department. What do you do, and how's business changed for you since the quarantine?
Well, for me personally, I own a construction company. I've been in business as long as I've been in the fire department. You know, so fortunately for me, you know, the whole thing has not affected me. We've continued to work. We've had some, you know, changes for shift and scheduling, just to work around, you know, some people that were doing work for that, you know, felt like they wanted to be safe in their place of work. So, you know, from that aspect, me personally and the people that work with me, we've been very fortunate. So, but I know it's affected a lot of people in a negative way. And, you know, I can't imagine what they're going through just trying to survive on a daily basis.
Yeah.
It's not, it can't be any fun.
No. Well, we appreciate, I'm glad that you're still able to work outside. Tell me about calls. Have your calls changed? Has the number of calls changed since the quarantine started?
Yes, it's changed a little bit. In the aspect, when it first all started, we really dropped off our call volume. You know, everybody was, you know, at home and, you know, abiding by all of it. So for the first, maybe I would say 2 weeks, the police and us and the EMS, it was quiet. But we've kind of gotten back to normal. You know, we noticed that the accidents dropped down because, you know, people weren't out driving as much. You know, we still have alarm calls, and fortunately for us, we've only had one call where we've had an exposure issue with somebody that's had the virus. I mean, not like this the squad does across the street. So, you know, again, from our perspective, I consider us very fortunate that we haven't had to deal with what the police and the EMS have been dealing with. as far as interaction with the people. We've been limited to that, which has made it good. So we haven't no one in our department has contracted it. No one's gotten sick. So far so good with all that.
Well, that's very good. I want to remind the folks, Immanuel, we feel like we're part of the community. We know that you guys are part of the community, and we consider you guys a blessing. So if it's all right with you, I'd like to pray now for you in particular, but also for, the volunteer. You have over 60 volunteers that serve here in one form or another.
Yes.
I'm going to pray for them, for their continued protection, and also that, this will all come to an end real soon. All right.
Can't wait.
Yeah, if you don't mind, I'll pray for you. Dear Lord, thank you for Andrew. Thank you for his willingness, Lord, to every day, Lord, whether it's a virus time or a quarantine or not, put his life on the line in service to others. And I just thank you for him and for the volunteers that are here at the fire department. Lord, I thank you for their bravery. I thank you for their sacrifice. And I know that's when they're most like you, is when they lay their lives down for other people. So Lord, I pray a special blessing on them. I pray for their protection. Lord, I just thank you for the good news that no one has been sick or affected by the virus so far. I pray that you continue to shield them from that. I pray that you would provide for their material needs, Lord, the guys who aren't able to work, Lord, that they would be able to be taken care of. Lord, for Andrew, as he has wisdom on how best to send his guys and his girls out onto jobs, give him the ability to make good decisions, Lord, for when to go in and when to stay back. I pray you protect him. I pray you put your mercy and your grace on the firehouse and all the people who are here. And I pray that you bring an end to this quarantine and then the virus and get us all healthy again safely and quickly, Lord. We pray in your name. Amen.
Amen.
Well, thanks for your time, Andrew. I appreciate
it. Thank you very much. I appreciate it, too.
Remember to be praying for these guys. Thank you.
So some of you have been keeping up with our improvements that's going on in the church right now to the facility itself. There was a picture that was taken just a day or two ago. I'm going to ask our crew to put up for you to see now. And if you see that picture, if it's there and you're looking at it, the picture is taken kind of with your back to our main entrance. When I say main, on Poplar Avenue, it's not the one that most people use. That's like it's kind of our official entrance. Most of you use the parking lot entrance, and that's what you're facing. When you look at the picture, you're going to see it's facing the narthex, the lobby of our church, with the sanctuary on your right, whether you can see it or not, the new elevators on your left, and there in the distance are the doors to go to the parking lot. And the reason I had them put that picture up is because you'll notice a lot of things have changed, but one thing is you're looking at a wooden floor. The carpet is gone there in the narthex in our lobby. And this week as I stood there, it hit me that the last time I saw that wooden floor was 26 years ago. 26 years ago. I became the pastor of Immanuel in 1993, and that following spring we launched into a whole project in 1994 for new carpeting, new pew padding, a new roof. As I stood there in the wood this week, I'm thinking, whoa, that was 26 years ago. It kind of just struck me, right? Our new carpeting, which is now gone, right? I thought about that. The carpet did pretty well. In the church, it's still holding up, but out in that narthex sanctuary, narthex lobby area, it had been, you've seen over the last years, a lot of buckling in there and different stuff, but with all the construction, it just, it was time. And thanks to your faithful giving, we were able to kind of, to say, let's get it done now while we're getting all the rest of this stuff done. But the carpet held up pretty well. Again, 26 years, right? 26 years. Carpet can't sustain itself forever, but it did for 26 years. Thought about that and our inability to sustain ourselves. How many, if all of us, sometimes it can be difficult to sustain a relationship for 26 years, right? I know for me, how difficult it is to sustain a weight loss diet for 26 days, right? I was involved in Concert of Prayer when I was in Bible college, and first time I was introduced to it, you know, singing, but a lot of concentrated prayer, it hit me of how hard it is to sustain a focus on prayer for 26 minutes. I'm so glad that our God doesn't have our weakness, right? We're going to see today in Scripture that the very God who created and designed this world gives evidence that he sustains it. We're going to see why he can and why that should cause you confidence, peace, joy as we move forward. So let's ask the Lord to move in our hearts. Father, we pray for you to calm us now in your word as we've been singing songs of praise to you and hearing different aspects of your work in our lives. Lord, we ask you to calm us. So many storms around us. We certainly pray for us as a nation, oh God, but we pray for us as your people right now. Calm us so that we can be those who carry your light to the world around us. And that doesn't come by finding energy in ourselves. It only comes by finding hope in you. And so do that in us, we pray today in the name of Jesus. Amen. Well, the first passage of Scripture I just want to bring to mind for us this morning is right in Acts 17. Now, we saw it last week, but Acts chapter 17, verses 24 to 26. And you'll see that listed there. And we read the Apostle Paul saying this: "The God who made the world and all things in it, since he is Lord of heaven and earth, does not dwell in temples made with hands. Neither is he served by human hands as though he needed anything, since he himself gives to all life and breath and all things. And he made from one every nation of mankind to live on all the face of the earth, having determined their appointed times and the boundaries of their habitation." Very important for us to see that aspect of God in here, but what it means to us as well. God sustains every life, right? He is the one, we read there, who gives to all life and breath. God sustains every life. So important for us to remember that. We have said it before, we will say it again. There is no place for racial bias, no place for ugly prejudice, no place for devaluing another human life based on any of that. We've preached it, but we have to continue to preach it and let that message continue to be so clear, not only in our words, but in our lives. That what do we read there? That God sustains every life. We need to keep saying it, but even more than just our words, the importance is that we personally value that in our daily lives, that I embrace that in how I live, that I look at that verse and I say, I embrace the truth that I am a child of Adam, just like every other human being, no matter what their skin color, no matter what their nationality, no matter what their origin, we are all of the same value. We take that forward. We see where we fail in that, and we need to just embrace it as human beings. Why? Because it's a human principle? No, because God sustains every life. Paul puts that out for us. He uses the same truth in Acts chapter 14, the evidence of God sustaining. Acts chapter 14, verses 15 to 17 there, where we Paul and Barnabas, they're in Lystra, and they have healed a man who was lame from birth. Right? You know, that they didn't take away his headache. They didn't somehow correct his back where nobody could affirm that. It was a miraculous sign in the name of Jesus. Somebody who never walked, they spoke words and he stood up and walked. And so the crowds do what? They come around and they start worshiping them. They're calling them Zeus and Hermes, different gods. What does Paul say there in Acts chapter 14, verses 15? Men, why are you doing these things? We are also men of the same nature as you. And we preach the gospel to you in order that you should turn from these vain things to a living God who made the heaven and the earth and the sea and all that is in them. And in the generations gone by, he permitted all the nations to go their own ways. And yet he did not leave himself without witness, in that he did good and gave you rains from heaven and fruitful seasons, satisfying your hearts with food and with gladness. What does Paul say? Listen, what are you doing? God, the creator God, the designer God, he has left evidence that he is sustaining this earth. We aren't. He is. He says that there. He didn't leave himself without a witness, without evidence. You see it over and over, the way he sustains us through rains and through care. In 1 Timothy chapter 6, the Apostle Paul writes to Timothy in 1 Timothy chapter 6, and he affirms the same truth, right? In verse 13, 1 Timothy 6:13, I charge you in the presence of God who gives life to all things. The word gives there is the Greek word zoogomeo. Zoo, yes, it has to do with, you know, life, right? You know, but it's referring to specifically to preserving life, to keeping alive. It's the same word Jesus uses in Luke when he says, if any man would save his life, would preserve his life, would keep it alive, you know, let him, you know, follow me, right? It's that aspect of sustaining. It's what the writer to the Hebrews says in Hebrews chapter 1 and verse 3. Hebrews 1:3, where we read about Jesus, that he is the radiance of his glory and the exact representation of his nature and upholds all things by the word of his power. New Living Translation there says sustains, but he upholds it all. A Christian philosopher, Ronald Nash, says this: had God not created the world in the first place, it would never have come into existence. And should God ever will to withdraw his sustaining power, the world would cease to exist. We saw that first part last week, right? The cosmological argument. We see the existence, there must be a cause, a creator. But it continues, so there must be a sustainer. Lambert Dolphin was a physicist at Stanford Research Institute for 30 years. He was a physicist there. And he says this: the nucleus of the atom contains positively charged and neutral principles, to use a simplistic model. Mutual electrostatic repulsion between the like positive protons would drive the nucleus apart if it were not for the strong force that binds the nucleus together. And of course, science has no answer to that mystifying source. It's just the power of nature, right? But what did he say, Lambert Dolphin, as a physicist for 30 years at Stanford Research? God must be behind the mysterious strong force that holds every atomic nucleus together. And that's what the Apostle Paul writes to the Colossians, right? In Colossians chapter 1 and verse 17, for what do we read there in Colossians 1:17? We read, speaking about Christ and his creative work, and he is before all things, and in him all things hold together. They're sustained. Why is it that my cells don't just come apart? They're being sustained, right? There's so many examples in Scripture of what God sustains. If you turn to Jeremiah chapter 5, and verses 22 to 24. Jeremiah chapter 5, verses 22 to 24. What do we read? We read about the tides and the seasons, right? We read in verse 22, do you not fear me, declares the Lord? Do you not tremble in my presence? For I have placed the sand as a boundary for the sea, an eternal decree, so it cannot cross over it. Are there times where there's storms and they come up? Sure. But what's it saying? God's sustaining where the oceans will be, right? Though the waves toss, yet they cannot prevail. In that passage down to verse 24, they do not say in their heart, let us now fear the Lord our God, who gives rain in its season, both the autumn rain and the spring rain, who keeps for us the appointed weeks of the harvest. He's sustaining it all. He sustains and tracks the stars. What does Isaiah say in Isaiah chapter 40, that incredible chapter where he just looks at the amazing aspects of God's power? In verse 26, lift up your eyes on high and see who has created these stars, the one who leads forth their host by number. He calls them all by name because of the greatness of his might and the strength of his power. Not one of them is missing. A little over 10 years ago, I preached a series on It's a Wonderful World, right? Some of you remember that. We looked at some of we even put some of the beauty of your art and creative things in our narthex, but we talked about the stunning design and the beauty of God's plan. And I remember working out a calculation. I remember sitting there with my calculator, making sure I got it all right so I didn't look silly, right? And I put a lot of time into it, so I'm going to use it again. You know, once every 10 years, I can pull it out, right? But if you were here then, you remember I said, if I got in my car and I set it on cruise control at 65 miles per hour, and I just stayed in the car and somehow it kept getting refueled, you know, while it kept moving, at the end of the day, I would have driven 1,560 miles. If I'm able to stay in that car 65 miles per hour for an entire year, I've traveled 570,000 miles. So I sat in my car 65 miles per hour, kept it at that for an entire year. I traveled 570,000 miles. To travel the distance in my car at that speed that light travels in 1 year, I would be sitting in my car for 10 million years. 10 million years going 65 miles per hour, I would travel the distance that light travels in 1 year, one light year. And yet astronomers have discovered the Sombrero Galaxy. It's being sustained. It's being held together 28 million light years from where we're standing. So I get in my car, set it to 65 miles per hour, stay in there for 10 million years, and I find out I got to do that 28 million more times. Right? My point is the vastness of what God's sustaining. He's holding it all together. That's our God. He sustains our orbit in the midst of that. In Job chapter 26, Job 26 and verse 7, what do we read? Job 26 and verse 7, he stretches out the north over empty space and he hangs the earth on nothing. God just sustains the earth. He sustains the grass and the trees. Psalm 104 and verse 14. Psalm 104 and verse 14, where we just read example after example of God's sustaining power. He causes the grass to grow for the cattle and vegetation for the labor of man, so that he may bring forth food from the earth. Dr. Henry Morris states that the laws of nature and thermodynamics insist that the source of power that holds all together must be outside and above the universe. It's just, it must be that there is a somehow never-beginning eternal source of power that sits above and outside the universe in order to sustain it. And that's why our God is able to do it. Earlier we looked at Colossians 1:17, and what did we see? We saw that all things are held together by him. But what did it say about him? Because he is before all things. Because he is before all things, he can sustain all things. In Isaiah chapter 42, the Lord declares that in Isaiah chapter 42 in verses 8 and 9, we read what? I am the Lord, that is my name. I will not give my glory to another, nor my praise to graven images. Verse to pass. And now I declare new things before they spring forth, I proclaim them to you. Before they do, I can do that. That's when the Lord sat with Job and was saying, listen, Job, I know you got a lot of questions, but remember, before this whole world existed, I was the one that was there. You weren't there, right? The nature of our God, Revelation chapter 1 declares that, right? In verse 8, that incredible truth about our God. You may get there quicker than me sometimes. Revelation chapter 1 and verse 8, I am the Alpha and the Omega, says the Lord God, who is and who was and who is to come, the Almighty. He is outside and above it all, and therefore he can sustain it. And he can sustain it because he's not losing any energy, right? We know the law of thermodynamics in our world, seeing things deteriorating, right? But not our God, because he sits outside and above it all. And Malachi, in the last book of the Old Testament, Malachi chapter 3 and verse 6, he says what? For I, the Lord, do not change. I never change. It's beautiful words we read about Jesus, right, in Hebrews 13. The same yesterday, today, and forever. Whew. Isaiah chapter 40, we realize how that impacts us personally, right? Who he is why he can sustain. And Isaiah shares that for us to take great comfort in it, right? Isaiah chapter 40, verse 28. Do you not know? Have you not heard? The everlasting God, everlasting, above and outside of it all, the creator of the ends of the earth, does not become weary or tired, and his understanding is inscrutable. He never sleeps or slumbers. He's never weary or tired, and his understanding is inscrutable. He never loses sight of what he's sustaining. Whew. One of the Pastor Herb Mitchell, decades before I was the pastor, and he was my pastor, a tremendous preacher, and I can't wait to see him again, you know, with the Lord. But one of our, you know, those of us who know and love him, you know, we've got some classic Pastor Mitchell stories. And one of them is involved with Bob D'Alessandro. Bob was a dear friend to Pastor, and Pastor would often call Bob over to help him for something at the house. And on one occasion, Pastor asked Bob to come over and do something up on his roof, get something fixed up on his roof. And so he got out his ladder, and Bob went up the ladder, and Bob was doing some stuff on the roof, and Pastor went inside, and Pastor forgot about Bob. Pastor came back out, took his ladder down, put it away, and Bob just remembers standing on the roof, and he sees Pastor Mitchell driving away in his car, and the ladder's gone, and, right? Left on the roof. And, you know, here's the thing. That's never going to happen to me. God, I'm never going to be, Lord, where are you going? He forgot me. Huh? Right? His understanding is inscrutable. I feel like he forgot me. He hasn't. He can sustain us. Because of who our God is, he never forgets you. He always sustains you. Nathan Busenitz has written a book, Why We Believe. He says this: at creation, God spoke the universe into existence. Since then, he continues to uphold it, and he does this in a personal and intimate way. See, when I talk about the Sombrero Galaxy, 28 million light years away, my mind doesn't, you know, finish just all the way out there in that distant, you know. It comes back to what? God has his eyes on me. That God who is sustaining a galaxy 28 million light years from here has his eyes on me. He has his eyes on me. He's sustaining me. I don't you know, I wasn't brilliant in my science classes. But I love this quote by Albert Einstein. Albert Einstein, the kind of the founder of modern physics. I could take a shot at a couple of his equations, but I'd rather than get them wrong here at this moment, right? But here's what I love that he said, Albert Einstein. I want to know how God created this world. I'm not interested in this or that phenomenon, in the spectrum of this or that element. I want to know God's thoughts. The rest are details. Think about what Einstein was saying. I want to know that personal sustaining God. I want to know his thoughts about me, because the evidence I'm seeing all around me in science affirms that he's there, right? I want to know his thoughts because it's personal. In Psalm 36, what do we read there about his personal sustaining care for us? Psalm 36, verse 7. How precious is thy loving kindness, O God! And the children of men take refuge in the shadow of thy wings. They drink their fill of the abundance of thy house, and thou dost give them to drink of the river of thy delights. For with thee is the fountain of life. In thy light we see light, right? What's he talking about there? They drink their fill of the abundance of your house. God, it never runs dry, right? It reminds me of Psalm 65 in verse 9. In Psalm 65 in verse 9, we read, thou dost visit the earth and cause it to overflow. Thou dost greatly enrich it. The stream of God is full of water. Thou dost prepare their grain, for thus thou dost prepare the earth. The stream of God, it never ends. He's above and outside it all. He's able to sustain us. I have memories from my childhood of people saying, if this, if that, you know what I mean? The kind of statements, you know, and I mean, like, in the realm like this, I would do this with my cheeks sometimes. You know, some of my siblings would as well, kind of chew the inside of our mouth. And my grandma McDevitt, who we love dearly, she would say to us, you better stop doing that because you're going to chew a hole right through your cheek. And I know somebody who has a hole in their cheek and it's been there their whole. You know, love you, Grandma McDevitt, if you're hearing me from heaven. She also told us it was important to eat burnt toast. And I'm reading that might not necessarily be true anymore. But anyhow, right? I remember in childhood somebody saying, "What if you're up at midnight, at the stroke of midnight, if you look in the mirror, the Jersey Devil's going to be standing behind you." I don't know how many of you heard that one, or if it was just somebody made it up to terrify me, but it worked. I can remember thinking, 11:59 or 12:01, I am not going to the bathroom at midnight because I don't want to look in the mirror, you know. But another one I remember getting, and the teacher meant well, when I was just a young child in school. The teacher said to me, I remember this, that if God ever forgets about you, you will die instantly. I can remember that. Yikes. And I can remember just, oh God, don't forget me. Oh God, don't forget me, right? Paul says, I got good news for you. He's never going to forget you. Child of God. Philippians chapter 1. What does the Apostle Paul say in verse 6? For I am confident of this very thing, that he who began a good work in you will perfect it until the day of Christ Jesus. Hypothetically, yeah, if God stopped thinking about me, I'd cease, right? But it's never going to happen, right? What does Paul say to you, to me, to any of us who come by faith to the saving work of Jesus? In Romans chapter 8 and verse 29, for whom he foreknew, he also predestined to become conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. And whom he predestined, these he also called, and whom he called, these he also justified, and whom he justified, these he also glorified. You come to faith in Christ, there's no doubt, there's no question, you're not going to ever get lost in the process. His thoughts are inscrutable. He never sleeps or slumbers. He brings us to himself, and he sustains us all through glory, right? Whew. Jesus spoke those words in Matthew chapter 28 and verse 20 that I want to leave you with, right? Words that are rooted in the evidence of Scripture that God sustains this earth. Jesus says what? I'm with you always, right? Teaching them to observe all that I can. I am with you always, even to the end of the age. He gets the last word. Christ is going to redeem this planet. If you're a child of God by faith, he'll sustain you till the end of the age and through all eternity, right? If you're not, oh dear friend, you need to come to Christ and find that everlasting life. See, God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him will not perish but have everlasting life, sustained life, in the hands of our God who sustains us. Would you pray with me? Almighty God, we thank you again for the comfort that we find in your sustaining power. The evidence around us of our Creator and Designer. The evidence around us that that Creator Designer sustains all things. Oh Lord, help us to humbly trust in you. Help us to be the ones who humbly come before you, our God, find that great confidence in you, and go forward to a world with that message to those who are hurting, lost, broken. The God of all creation values every life. If you'll come to him in faith, he'll sustain you forever. Oh, Lord, we can only do it with you, and so we pray this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen.
Jesus, blood and righteousness, I dare not.
know that next Sunday, obviously the first Sunday of June, after our live stream service, in the afternoon from 1 o'clock to 3 o'clock, Pastor Greg and I will be over in the church parking lot. If you would like to come to the parking lot to share communion, us with you, the Lord's table, we'll do that. You pull up and we'll be able to work that out. So we'll be doing it in our live stream, but wanted to offer that to you as well, you know, in our parking lot next Sunday from 1 to 3 o'clock, weather permitting, right? And now may the blessing of God the Father and God the Son and God the Holy Spirit rest and abide on each and every one of us, now and until Jesus Christ comes again, and then forever, we pray. Amen.